Welcome to Shah's IAS Institute. All the very best to all the students who have appeared for UPSC Civil Services Prelims Examination. In this video, we are going to discuss the General Studies Paper 1 which was conducted today on 2nd June 2019. So the paper which I have with me is Set D. So there are 100 questions in the paper as you know, and we'll start with the Set D and first question in this. So here is the question. With reference to Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, consider the following statements. So there are three statements with respect to AIIB. AIIB has prominently been in news for the last few years actually, and it continues to be in news. And you should know this is a bank which is majorly funded and promoted by China. So China is one which has the largest share in this. So India is the largest shareholder of AIIB is clearly wrong. Anybody who has heard of and has read a little about AIIB would know this second statement is wrong. And AIIB does not have any member from outside Asia is also incorrect. So if you have looked at the list, we have actually covered this in our current affairs. You can see this is the answer key given here. So this first question is from multilateral organizations. The correct answer for it is A. How did we come to that? We'll discuss. But here you can see China's voting share at AIIB is 28.7%, which is substantially larger than the second largest AIIB member nation, which is India. So here you can see this is a website where we have covered this news. So this is 4th May 2018 page. So here you can see AIIB is the last news item on this page. So we'll go down here. And here you can see Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. The complete detail is given when it was established, how many member nations are there. And if you look at it, you can see it's not just Asian members. You have members from other countries also, from other continents also, like European countries have also joined in. You can see they are interested in joining and they have joined in. So number of members have significantly increased. So the correct answer here then would be first statement. You may or may not know, we can keep it pending, but second statement is surely wrong. AIIB does not have any member from outside Asia is surely incorrect. So when 2 and 3 statements are incorrect, the correct answer can be only A, one only. So the correct answer for this is A. Then second question is, what was the purpose of intercreditor agreement signed by Indian banks and financial institutions recently? So this is regarding intercreditor agreement. So again, this has been in news. We have covered it. You can see this is a website where this coverage is. So on 24 July 2018, here you can see in banking related news. Here, economy banking. Banks agree to resolve stressed assets quickly. The 14th number news. Here we have covered this. So here you can see this is ICA, intercreditor agreement. So the agreement known as intercreditor agreement was framed under the aegis of Indian Banks Association, and it is detailed out here. So what is it? So it is an agreement among banks that have dues from a borrower in stress. So the pact mandates the lead bank to formulate a resolution plan that will be executed in a time-bound manner. So you understand that this is regarding non-performing assets, NPAs, and when there is a particular borrower who has taken loan from various banks. So one of the banks from whom the major loan has been taken, a major chunk has been taken, who has a maximum share, that becomes the lead bank. It formulates a resolution plan is what this intercreditor agreement calls for. So that's what the question is. What was the purpose of intercreditor agreement signed by Indian banks and financial institutions? So of course, out of these four, you can see lessen government's burden of fiscal deficit, current account deficit is not applicable. Support the infrastructure projects? No. To act as independent regulator? No. To aim at faster resolution of stressed assets? So that is correct, and you can see of rupees 50 crore or more, that is also part of the pact. You can see it's applicable to all corporate loans above 50 crore rupees. So that is a correct option. So answer for this, correct answer for this is D. So this is economy banking related news, related question. Then third question is, the chairman of public sector banks are selected by the, so there are four options given. So if you have been doing current affairs, you must have heard about Banks Board Bureau. So there's a new body which has been established, and you can see we have covered it in news quite often too. So two examples are given here, you can see. So if we look at it, the coverage here in which Banks Board Bureau has been mentioned. So this is with respect to banking again. So here you can see BBB, Banks Board Bureau. So that is 14th number news, second last news here. So we'll go down to it. So this is the Banks Board Bureau. So it was established. You can see. the detail of bank's board bureau given here. So it was established to recommend names as such too. So with a view to improve government public sector banks, the government has decided to set up bank's board bureau. So it has been established and announced as such in budget 2015-16 and was established later. So the founding chair was also former Comptroller and Auditor General of India, Shri Vinod Rai. Later, it has been, the names which it has recommended for posts, the government has refused to accept them. That is secondary, but at least selection. Now, the question is also important. It does not say appointment. The appointment is finally done by the government, but selection of candidates for the posts, top posts at public sector banks is done by Banks Board Bureau. RBI does not play any role in this. Management of concerned banks does not play a role. So, it's the Banks Board Bureau which selects the candidates and final appointment is done by the union government. So, the correct answer here is also A. Then the fourth question is, consider the following statements. Petroleum and Natural Gas Regulatory Board is the first regulatory body set up by the Government of India. So, of course, we have many regulatory bodies established. This cannot be the first regulatory body. So, of course, this is highly improbable. It's completely incorrect. So, this is wrong. Then second statement says, one of the tasks of Petroleum and Natural Gas Regulatory Board is to ensure competitive markets for gas. So, of course, it's a regulatory body. It will ensure competitive markets. So, you can assume it is true, but you will get better help when you look at the options too. So, one when one is surely incorrect. So, the options which stay for with you are only B, 2 and 3. So, when one is surely incorrect, this is a very simple question. The answer here is B, 2 and 3. Third statement is actually vague. You may feel this may not be correct. Like it says, appeals against the decisions of Petroleum and Natural Gas Regulatory Board go to the appellate tribunals for electricity. So though you may think that Petroleum Natural Gas, why would it go to appellate tribunal for electricity? But this is actually correct. They go to appellate tribunal. There are examples to the links for which we have provided here. You can see for question number 4. So this is there. So, correct answer for 4 is B. And it's a very simple question. So, when one is surely incorrect, the answer becomes evident, it's B. Then next is, with reference to communication technologies, what is are the differences between LTE and VoLTE? So, LTE, long-term evolution, has come quite often in news. We have also covered it quite often. The first statement actually says this is commonly marketed as 3G, where it is completely incorrect. LTE is related to 4G. 5G is a new technology, which you know, new generation of telecom technology, which would come in. So LTE is 4G. So this is completely incorrect. And VoLTE is also LTE, voice over LTE. So of course, it would also not be related to 3G. So one statement is incorrect. About second statement, LTE is a data only technology, but VoLTE is voice only technology, is the second statement given here. So you should know that though LTE is data only technology, but VoLTE can provide voice over technology also, and it has data capacity also. So you can see VoLTE has, it is said, up to 3 times more voice and data capacity than 3G. So of course, it's not voice only, it can transfer data as such too. So the statement 5 as such, which is given, question 5 in this, the first option is surely incorrect, but the second option is also incorrect. So the correct answer here is D. Which of the statements are correct? Neither one nor two. Then next question, number 6 is, which of the following statements is are correct regarding Maternity Benefit Amendment Act 2017? So this is regarding the Maternity Benefit Act. You should know that it has been amended. Provisions have been expanded. So first one, it says pregnant women are entitled for 3 months pre-delivery and 3 months post-delivery paid leave. So here you should know that pre-delivery leave actually should not, need not be so much. Post-delivery leave is more so required. So this gives you some kind of inkling that this may not be correct, but we'll wait and watch. We're not very sure right now, just in the way you can solve the questions. So second question, second statement says enterprises with creches, where crash facilities available where children can be kept. So enterprises with crashes must allow the mother minimum 6 crash visits daily. So that is the second statement. And third statement says women with 2 children get reduced entitlements. So here, if you know about the scheme and generally what you hear about, you know, maximum number of children which are encouraged are 2. So number 3 statements gives you an inkling that this may be true. So, since it is an amendment, what has actually been done is expanded leave, paid leaves have been provided for pregnant women, but for women with 2 children, already 2 children, if she gets pregnant again, for them, the extended leaves benefits are not available. So reduced entitlements, third statement is correct, first statement is incorrect. So even with this much information, that first statement is incorrect and third is correct. So third is correct, you have this, and first incorrect, you are left with only one option, C can be the answer. So if you look at the answer explanation too over here, you can see C is the correct answer for the sixth question, and we have the explanation here too. You can see on our website too, we have covered this. This is social woman related news. So here you can see paid maternity leave extended to 26 weeks. That is the third news item. So here is the news. So this is regarding parliamentary nod to the maternity benefit amendment bill. So women working in organized sector will be entitled to paid maternity leave of 26 weeks up from 12 weeks. So 12 weeks benefits are there for children, for two children, for the third child, you know, you can see for the third child, the maternity leave entitlement will only be for 12 weeks. Extended is for others. So, and it's applicable to all establishments employing 10 or more people. So that is written here. So of course, for the creche facility, we need more information. So that is also given here, you can see. So the creche facility is available and the woman is permitted to visit creche 4 times during a day, including rest intervals. So this is from Wikipedia. You can get the entire detail of the Maternity Benefit Amendment Act of 2017, which gives these details. And you can see the for women who are expecting, you can see extended paid leave which is given. So it can be up to maximum of 8 weeks before the expected delivery date and remaining. So out of 26 weeks, 8 weeks can be before delivery and remaining time is available for post-childbirth. So of course, it's not equally divided pre and post. So first statement, that's why we said pre-delivery, post-delivery, this is incorrect. So that is there. Then seventh question, which is a very easy question, which has prominently been in use quite often. So this is, which one of the following is not a sub-index of the World Bank's Ease of Doing Business Index? So every student who has been sincerely preparing for civil services and has been doing economy and even preparing current affairs would have come across this quite often. So these are the four options given here. So there are sub-indices. So under World Bank's Ease of Doing Business Index, there are 10 sub-indices. Out of these four, one is not that. So out of these four, which is not, we'll have to look at the list. So here you can see on our website too, we have covered it quite often. This is one of the news items from the date 15 June 2017. So even often it has been covered. So here you can see it is in the end economy related news. The news was India aims to lift doing business ranking. So this is regarding the parameters, 10 parameters. So here you can see getting electricity, paying taxes, construction permits. So these are the three options actually given: paying taxes, registering property, construction permits. So these are part of this list. Which is not is maintaining law and order. So maintenance of law and order, 7A is the correct answer. This is not a sub-index in ease of doing index of World Bank. Then next is 8th question. In India, extended producer responsibility was introduced as an important feature in which of the following? So extended producer responsibility, if you think of this terminology, it has also been quite often in news. You can see on our website too, we have covered it in current affairs, extended producer responsibility. So this is environment related news. So with respect to the plastic question too, it has prominently been discussed. But this question is more so of understanding. So what is extended producer responsibility is when a producer produces a commodity, he has to take it back. It's not that once he's produced it and has sold it off, it's done, but you have to have take back programs because the product after being used, it becomes a waste and results in pollution. So recycling is required. So producer takes back. So that's the extended producer responsibility. And if you think of it, generally we hear of this EPR, extended producer responsibility, in case of electronic equipments. So that is why in India too, it has been introduced. The question is, it has been part of many provisions now. The Supreme Court has clearly endorsed this quite often, extended producer responsibility, but it was introduced as an important feature in the e-waste management and handling rules of 2011. Not biomedical, not recycled plastic, but in e-waste. So by even common sense and some logic applied, you can come to this conclusion that it is C. So for 8, the correct answer is C. Then ninth one, the ninth question, it is the economic cost of food grains to the Food Corporation of India is MSP, minimum support price, and bonus, if any, paid to the farmers plus. So for Food Corporation of India, which procures food grains for farmers, what is the cost incurred, the economic cost incurred? So of course it will be the MSP, which it pays to the farmers, at which it buys the crop from the farmers. It may have to pay any bonus, if any, plus what? So plus, of course, transportation cost also has to be incurred by Food Corporation of India, but the first option says transportation cost only. So that is only is the, you know, the third word which makes you understand that this may not be the correct answer. We'll have to look further. B is interest cost only. C says procurement incidentals and distribution costs. Of course, Food Corporation of India procures food grains, so that procurement process includes transportation in some way too, and distribution, procurement and distribution is also has to be done. Charges for go down, sometimes FCI may have its own go downs, but procurement and distribution for cost surely will have to be incurred by FCI. So the best option for this is C. So ninth, the correct answer is C. So here also FCI has been covered, but such economic cost incurred by FCI has not been covered in news items. But you can see here, this is the coverage given FCI's economic cost. So if you look at it here, you can see distribution cost, acquisition cost, procurement incidental. So these terminologies are over here. So for the ninth question, the correct answer is C. Then tenth question. In the context of any country, which one of the following would be considered as part of its social capital? So this is a very simple question. We hear about economic capital, human capital, and now what is being spoken of is social capital. So economic capital is of course money, which is required for any enterprise. Human capital is human resource, which is required, and this is social capital. So A option you can see is proportion of literates in the population. So of course this is human capital. Stock of its buildings, other infrastructure, machinery, this is economic capital, you know, material which is required. C is size of population in the working age group, again human capital. And D talks of level of mutual trust and harmony in the society. So of course for 10th question, the correct answer is D. So this is just by simple understanding. Then for 11th question, the question is, the service area approach was implemented under the purview of, there are four schemes given here, you can see schemes and missions, programs mentioned. So service area, you should know, was under lead bank scheme. When you have done schemes in detail, you would come across it. There is no service area approach in NREGA and in rural development or skill development. So it is the lead bank scheme for banks as such. Priority being given, you know, to the rural areas. So the service area approach is part of lead bank scheme. So for 11th question, the correct answer is B. Then next is, with reference to the management of minor minerals in India, consider the following statements. So this is with respect to sand. Let's say sand is a minor mineral according to prevailing law in the country. So here actually the statement is correct. We will see in the answer to. This is actually a PIB related news, so of December 2016 actually, in which it says sand is a minor mineral. So guidelines for sand mining were given. So it's 2016 related, PIB information. So it says yes, sand mining is sand is a minor mineral. So for first statement, of course, we can see it is correct. Second statement says state governments have the power to grant mining leases for minor minerals, but the powers regarding formation of rules lie with central government. This is actually incorrect. If you look at the guidelines, it clearly states that state governments make rules for regulating the grant of mineral concessions too. So even rules are made by state governments. Second statement is incorrect, and state governments have the power to frame rules to prevent illegal mining of minor minerals is also true. So everything, you know, connected therewith. So for that, the power is with the state governments. Legislative and administrative domain is of the state government. So here you can see state governments have framed their own minor mineral concession rules too. Control of illegal mining is therefore under the legislative and administrative jurisdiction of state governments. So that is why for here, option 1 is correct, option 3 is correct, option 2 is incorrect. So the correct answer here would be excluding 2, it is 1 and 3, so A. So for 12th, the correct answer is A. Then question 13 is, consider the following statements. There are two statements given. It says, most of India's external debt is owned by governmental entities. And second statement is all of India's external debt is denominated in US dollars. So second statement you can see is clearly incorrect. We'll not be taking only US dollars. If we take loans from European countries or from European government entities or any other entity, it may be in euro and other hard currencies too. So second statement also looks highly improbable, and most of it owned by governmental entities means we have external debt is being taken, but from governmental entities only, most of it too. So that also is highly improbable because we take it from multilateral groupings also. So loans taken from multilateral groupings are not government entities, they are multinationals like IMF, World Bank, etc. So actually both the statements are incorrect. We'll see at the explanation too. You can see 78.8% of India's total external debt is owed by non-governmental entities like private companies. So when private companies take loans, that is also India's loan. It's not just the government taking loan. So external debt, that is also an external debt, a liability on the country. So 78.8% is non-governmental, owed by non-governmental entity, and we also take it. And here again, that clarity is also required. Whom are we taking it from? Owed to and owed by. So who is the OE? It's owed by private enterprises, not by governmental entities. That, and it is owed to governmental entities as well as multinational bodies. So that is there. So first statement is incorrect, and second, you can see India's external debt is held in multiple currencies, the largest of which is of course US dollar. So here the correct answer is D. For 14th one, it is which of the following is not included in the assets of a commercial bank in India. So we talk of non-performing assets so often, so you should understand what is an asset. So when asset becomes non-performing, so when advances, loans are given by bank, they are its assets. So it is an asset for the bank, but when it becomes non-performing, it is an NPA. So advances are of course an asset. Any investment made by the bank, of course it is expecting returns from it, so that is an asset. Money at call and short notice in bank, interbank transactions which are taking place, that is also an asset. But deposits are a liability. When any customer, any person has a deposit, savings account or capital account, a deposit with the bank, so it is a liability on the bank to pay back to that customer. So deposits are liability. So here what is not included in assets, 14, the correct answer will be B. So by simple elimination and understanding also you can understand this. And this, if you want factual information too, it is shown here, financial assets of commercial bank. But without that also this question can be easily solved. Then next question, the 15th question, it says, in the context of India, which of the following factors is our contributors to reducing the risk of currency crisis? So rupee volatility was seen in recent times too. So there is a risk of a currency crisis. So in that case, what factors are contributing to reducing this risk? So to reduce the risk, what steps can be taken? So what is happening is there is more rupee in the economy. So rupee's value is decreasing. So what one thing is done is foreign currency earning of Indian's IT sector when it is coming into the country. So by getting more of dollars, that is good. So it reduces the risk of currency crisis, increasing the government expenditure. So government expenditure increases is not going to reduce the risk of any crisis. So of course that increasing government expenditure may not be the answer here surely. And remittances from Indians abroad. So remittances from abroad are also in foreign currency. So that is good for strengthening rupee. So 1 and 3 strengthen rupee. Government expenditure increasing plays no role here. So the correct answer here will be 1 and 3. So 15, the correct answer is B. So that is also a very simple question. No much explanation required. Then 16th question, it says, which one of the following suggested that the governor should be an eminent person from outside the state and should be a detached figure without intense political links or should not have taken part in politics in recent past? So this is actually regarding center-state relations. Governor plays a role which may affect center-state relations if center and state governments are not from the same political party. So governor plays a role here. So there was this Sarkaria Commission on Center-State Relations. Anyone who has done polity in detail would have studied about it, and this is a very simple question. So here 16, the answer is Sarkaria Commission C. Then 17th one, which of the following is issued by registered foreign portfolio investors to overseas investors who want to be part of Indian stock market without registering themselves directly? So this is also an issue which has quite often been in news. So somebody who has been preparing will have this question very easily solved. So there are FPIs, foreign portfolio investors, FPI or FII, not FDI. So foreign portfolio investors, they invest in the country, but then there are overseas investors who don't themselves want to be registered, but they still want to invest in India, in Indian stock market. So they can do this indirectly, and that is called P notes, participatory notes. So that is the route through which they can invest, though government wants to constrain this and, you know, restrict this. So this is, the answer here is 17D, participatory notes. Then 18th question. As per law, the Compensatory Afforestation Fund Management and Planning Authority exists at both national and state level. So yes, that is correct. And people's participation is mandatory in Compensatory Afforestation Program carried out under Compensatory Afforestation Fund Act. So Compensatory Afforestation, CAMPA, when it was announced, to it was for compensatory, you know, funding being provided by private entities or companies or even public enterprises which are taking over land, which forest land. So in that case, they have to, if they are affecting the environment adversely, they have to undertake afforestation. So there is this fund which is generated. So whatever compensatory amount which they have to pay for destroying forest land or any other such activity, so they provide this fund. Money to the fund. So that compensatory afforestation fund, in that people's participation becoming mandatory, has no role to play. So second statement, if you know about CAMPA and about this act, you will clearly know that there is nothing like people's participation in that. So second statement is clearly incorrect. And of course, they'll be there at both national and state level. So here the correct answer is A. 18 is A. Then 19th one. In India, which of the following review the independent regulators in sectors like telecommunication, insurance, electricity, etc.? So review of independent regulators take place. So which of the following review, actually parliamentary committees do review of all bodies, including independent regulators too. So parliamentary department related standing committees do review, and ad hoc committees may also be reviewing. So either it may be one or two. And Niti Aayog actually has been given the task of reviewing independent regulators. So it has been playing a role. So Niti Aayog being mentioned in the options make it dicey. It may be 2 and 5 or 1 and 2. And both are options. 1 and 2 and 2 and 5 both. So maybe 2 and 5 is the answer. So for 19th one, it may not be very sure. But there is this news. You can see Niti Aayog working on regulator reforms bill. So it is also reviewing the functioning of regulatory authorities. So in that sense, it may be the case. The next is, with reference to India's 5-year plans, which of the following statements are correct? So this is regarding 5-year plans. 5-year plans have become obsolete now. Niti Aayog has been established, but still a question has been asked on 5-year plans on 4th, 2nd, 4th and 5th 5-year plan. There are 3 statements. So though planning commission and 5-year plans are obsolete, questions can still be asked. So it says, from the 2nd 5-year plan, there was a determined thrust towards substitution of basic and capital goods industries. So now substitution word comes in 2nd 5-year plan. It comes for import substitution, not, and promotion of basic and capital goods industries, not substitution of these. So the statement is incorrectly framed. So the statement is not correct, basically. So one statement is incorrect. Second statement, it says the 4th 5-year plan adopted the objective of correcting the earlier trend of increased concentration of wealth and economic power. So 4th 5-year plan was the first plan under Indira Gandhi, and it spoke on, you know, reducing this concentration of wealth. 5th 5-year plan came up with Garibi Hatao too. So second statement is correct. And this is 5th 5-year plan. In the 5th 5-year plan, for the first time, financial sector was included as an integral part of the plan. So this you should know. If you have done 5-year plans, you will know this was around 9th 5-year plan, not 5th 5-year plan. So third statement is incorrect. So only second statement is correct. So the correct answer is B. So that is here. You can see. The explanation is also given here. Then for question number 21. It is, with reference to the Constitution of India, consider the following statements. No High Court shall have the jurisdiction to declare any central law to be constitutionally invalid. So now you should understand that High Courts also have jurisdiction. It's not like federal government like in USA. We have an integrated judiciary. We do not have separate jurisdiction for our judiciary. So it is appeals that case go up to Supreme Court. So High Court can also declare any central law to be unconstitutional too. So first statement is incorrect. And second says, an amendment to the Constitution of India cannot be called into question by the Supreme Court of India. Then what is judicial review if this is this statement is correct? So of course this statement is incorrect. So the correct answer here is D, neither one nor two. Then So here you can see the explanation given to 21 is D. So that is simple understanding. 22, first statement is purchasing power parity exchange rates are calculated by comparing the prices of the same basket of goods and services in different countries. So if you know about PPP, purchasing power parity, this is the definition. Of course, this is true. Second statement says in terms of PPP dollars, India is the sixth largest economy in the world. And if you have done a little of it, India does not come at sixth. In PPP terms, it comes at second or third place, surely not at sixth. So actually, India is third largest. So here you can see India is seventh largest economy in nominal terms, but third in terms of purchasing power parity exchange rate. So the correct answer for 22 is A. One only is correct. Two is incorrect. Then question number 33. It says, with reference to cultivation of kharif crops in India in the last 5 years, consider the following statements. One is area under rice cultivation is the highest. So, of course, rice cultivation may be high, but this is again very factual. You may not be able to clearly understand and, you know, mark the question. This is a difficult question. It's very factual. Second statement says area under cultivation of jawar is more than that of oil seeds. Frankly speaking, I did not even get any data on this. Third says area of cotton cultivation is more than that of sugarcane. We have data on this, we'll show you. And fourth says area under sugarcane cultivation has steadily decreased. So on this 23rd question, you can see we have this annual report of Agriculture Corporation, Department of Agriculture Corporation. So this lists out the detail on area under cultivation for various crops. So here it is. On page 3 itself, I suppose it is there. So here you go. So area, production and yield of major crops. So you can see its latest figure given is of 2015-16, but it will give us a clear indication. It may not have drastically changed. So rice cultivation, you can see area is maximum. Then comes wheat. So first statement, of course, is correct. Then second statement, sugarcane and cotton, if you look at the area under cultivation, cotton area is much higher. So that was the statement 3. So 1 is correct. Area of cotton cultivation is more than that of sugarcane is also correct. So 1 and 3 are for sure correct. So with 1 and 3 correct, you have option A and option D. So for that, 2 and 4 should also be correct. And area under sugarcane cultivation is steadily declined. On this, actually, the data is there that it has been increasing and decreasing. So it has not been steadily declining. So there's no such clear trend. So fourth statement cannot be clearly, you know, asserted. So that is why 1 and 3, A is the correct option. So without even knowing about 2, A is the correct answer here. But it is a difficult question. It may be by fluke that some may have got it correct. So yes, it comes under difficult question category. Then next is, among the agricultural commodities imported by India, which one of the following accounts for the highest imports in terms of value in the last 5 years? So agricultural commodities are also imported. And here you have this coverage on agricultural imports. So here it is, you can see agricultural imports. It says among the major food imports, you can see maximum import is of edible oil. So this is over the years given. So the trend is also clearly evident. It is edible oil. So then comes pulses. Wheat import has increased. The coverage is also basically on how wheat import has increased recently. So, from the options which we have here, spices, fresh fruits, pulses and vegetable oils, the correct answer is D, vegetable oils. So, that's the 24th one. Then 25th one, again, a very simple question. It says, in the context of polity, which one of the following would you accept as the most appropriate definition of liberty? So, what is liberty? So, liberty, basically, it says protection against the tyranny of political rulers. So, you're not oppressed. That is liberty. Not just being oppressed is not enough. So liberty should be in positive sense. Absence of restraint. So no restraint, that is also not true. We have restrictions on fundamental rights too. So complete absence of restraint is also not what we require. Opportunity to do whatever one likes. Again, complete absence of restraint. This is also incorrect. D says opportunity to develop oneself fully. So that is liberty. So appropriate definition for liberty, 25. D is the correct answer. So in this part 1 of the video on GS1 paper, we'll cover first 25 questions from set D. Remaining parts will also be covered, remaining questions. So wish you all the very best and hope you have been doing well and keep watching. Thank you so much.